Has its own nature. Similarly, the nature of the mind is chanchala, disturbed, the distracted state. As it is very chanchala, very difficult to control, then why do you again and again insist to control the mind, control the mind? Let's say Krishna says, asamshayam mahabhaho mano durnigraham chalam abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena cha labhyate. Of course, obviously, O Arjuna, O great warrior mahabhaho, it's very difficult to control the mind, but surely there must be a way. There is nothing in the world which doesn't have any solution. Yes, every problem, every question has its own solution. So what are the different ways to control the mind? Abhyasena tu kaunteya vairagyena cha labhyate. Abhyasa, the continuous practice, as well as the detached attitude towards the each and every activities and its results. Vairagya is not that we run away from the situation. Being in all the situations, being engaged in all the works and activities, we have to be detached with the results of the actions, the vairagya. So abhyasa, we have to choose what to practice. Because until and unless we know what to be practiced, how to be practiced, when to be practiced, how it must be guided by someone, until and unless we decide all these, we can't go for simply through the practice. So abhyasa should be understood. The nature of the abhyasa must be understood first. Then what to be practiced, we have to think. At last, the different practices which are prescribed by the scriptures, as well as the practices practiced by the yoga masters and realized the results of those practices, we have to follow. Patanjali brought out the beautiful attributions or the different characteristics of abhyasa. He says, Satu dirghakala nairantarya satkara sevito drudhagomi. Any practice you take, because if you want to establish any practice, or even if you overcome the bad habit what we have addicted for, to overcome that bad habit, you have to continue for a long time taking some principle of practices. So we have to channelize the mind towards other practices. So Patanjali says, Sadhu, whichever the practice you choose must be practiced for dirghakala, long time. Because as we have habituated, you cannot overcome very easily. It is not possible within a day or a week or a month. You need to. Example, if you take a doctor would like to be a very great surgeon, then he has to practice for many years. Until and unless he practice, he cannot establish. Any sportsman, to establish in his own practice, he has to dedicate the time for over a long period. Similarly, if you take any field in the world, any stream in your life journey, everything demands the time. That's why any practice to be established at the final state needs dirghakala, a long time, dirghakala. Then the second aspect is nairantarya, every day. Example, if you want to practice music, you stop, just begin the practice of music. You can't think that today I will practice and tomorrow, yeah, day after tomorrow, yeah, again I will start the next week. No. Anything to be mastery, because it should flow into our blood cells. That's why it should be practiced every day, nirantara. Otherwise, there will be a break. You cannot have the continuity in the practice. So you choose the practice and practice it for a long time, and it must be continuously practiced every day, nirantarya. And the third aspect is very important. Satkara sevito drudha bhumi. Satkara sevito, you should have a firm faith, unshakable faith towards the practice. You should have the faith that if I practice this, I will establish. You must strongly believe the words of the scriptures as well as a guru. Because of our priorities are different, whatever the practice we take, it will be deviated then and there, because we want different taste with different practices. The moment you look for different, nowhere we will establish. So Patanjali says, take up one practice or take up one idea, as Vivekananda says, take up one idea, dream it. Until and unless you get into that state, continuously go for it. Whenever you have a strong faith, unshakable faith, with continued practice and for a long time, surely one will establish in drudha bhumi. It becomes firm, it becomes established. But at the same time, even though you practice for a long time and continuous practice every day with unshakable faith, but parallelly you must practice vairagya also. Vairagya is a detached state of the mind or detachment. Drishtanushravita vishaya vidrushnasya vashikara sanya vairagyam. Patanjali says, drishta anushravita vishaya vidrushnasya. Vishaya vidrushnasya means the sense organs have the nature to go behind the objects of enjoyment, because their nature, you can't control their nature, because their nature, you cannot control the flow of water for a long time. If you control somewhere in the reservoir and all, how far you can control? Once it reaches its peak level, surely it will overflow. So what we can do, we can channelize the water to some other direction so that we can control. Similarly, we have to control the mind by channelizing to different practices. Here Patanjali says, the indriya's nature is to go behind the object of enjoyment, vishaya vitrishnasya. Then what we have to do? Drishta anushravika. Wherever you come across, either in the presence or the absence of the object, either in the presence or the absence of what you hear or you physically come across, you have to be neutral. That doesn't mean be neutral and be still without doing anything, being a lazy, no. You have to engage 100% in each and every activity. But either the sukha or the dukkha, either in the presence or the absence, you should not be craving, you should not be crazy. Vishaya vitrishnasya vashikara sanya, as a tortoise slowly and gradually absorbs, like it draws all the limbs. You have to withdraw all your sense organs from the external nature. That is the way we have to be neutral. Like in most of the situation you are working, but at the same time you are not working, like a pratyahara vyasa. You are enjoying but not attached to the enjoyment. The moment you attach, it develops the raga, it develops the possession, it develops. The moment you possess, then you will establish your ego, then it leads to desha also, at the same time hatredness. So the abhyasa and vairagya must go hand in hand. This doesn't mean that just I will go through the practice at the later age, older age, I will practice vairagya detachment. No. It should go hand in hand. And we have to decide what to be practiced. Because we cannot go for the higher practices as a common human beings right now. Because our first priority is physical fitness, health. Once you maintain the health, shariramadhyam khalu dharma sadhanam, whenever the body is absolutely fit and healthy, then we can go for the practices. Most of the people think that they will get lot of enthusiasm at the later age, but by the time physical body is absolutely collapsed, no energy, they have lost the energy because of the continuous work and the enjoyment throughout the life, the indriyas have lost their power, the physical body has lost its power. You don't have any energy to go aggressively. So, whenever we are ill, we have to get into the practices. So that at the later age, no need to suffer. Even at the time of death, we can be in the state of yoga. How it is possible means, if you continuously practice throughout the lifestyle, as a lifestyle, you have to practice. That's why Krishna says, even at the time of death, prayanakale manasa chalena bhaktya yukto yoga palena chaiva bhrugo madhye pranamavesha samyaku satam param purusham upaiti divyam. At the time of death, if you are a real yoga practitioner, you can bring your prana, your vital force, your shakti at the eyebrow center. Prayanakale manasa chalena bhaktya yukto yoga palena chaiva. It is not only the yoga bala, it will have the bala of the divine power. Bhaktya, if you are surrendered, if you are completely surrendered to the God, then with that power, using the yoga bala, yoga shakti, the technique of the yoga, you can bring that power into the Ajna Chakra, the eyebrow center. Whenever you bring that prana bala at the eyebrow center, naturally he attains the liberation without any difficulties. He can go out of the body, he can move further, taking the prana out of the body without any difficulty. Purusham upaiti divyam, he attains that ultimate abode. So yoga is not only to attain the liberation, but also it teaches how to successfully continue our life journey without having any troubles or the diseases or the disorders. First, we have to establish the physical fitness and the health so that using the sharira, we can go for the sadhana. So this tool must be trained every day in a proper way. This is the way all the scriptures gives to maintain the steadiness of the body, health of the body, fitness of the body, and you choose your own practices. Whichever you wish to continue, either asanas or pranayama, or any japa, or any kind of yoga, whichever you are interested in, or you go through the contemplation of the jnana yoga, the bhakti yoga, the karma yoga, raja yoga, there are huge number of paths, but it must be followed by any guru parampara. You must follow a lineage so that you will be guided properly in that order. You cannot decide yourself. Of course you can, but it is very rare case. If you are completely born with those qualities, daivi guna, if you continue, they carry forward the samskaras from the previous path of sadhana, you may not need guru. Your antaratma, your inner being itself guides us in the practice. But for the common people, we can choose some of the Guru Parampara, the lineage, so that we will be guided in a proper way to continue our life journey. So, there are huge number of aspects are discussed in the Bhagavad Gita, and we have to choose which is our path, what are the practices. So, having understood the different aspect in the light of Bhagavad Gita, let us continue our life journey to make it more successful. Thank you very much. Om.